Hey, Jonah.
Hey, Mickey.
Debating somebody from the National Review gives me the rare opportunity to be on the left on Blogging Hits TV.
Congratulations. I'm sure it's a wonderful feeling.
Thank
for you.
I will try desperately to be a Democrat and attack you from the left.
Okay, well, don't get a hernia. Just do what you got to do.
Despite my tendencies to attack other Democrats. So this is a new experience for me. And I know you wanted to talk about Charlie Sheen's divorce.
Well, who doesn't?
But I think that just provides a sort of backdrop to everything we'll be talking about.
I think you're right. I think it informs the zeitgeist on a whole bunch of levels.
Right, right. It's all a reaction, I guess the dramatic revelations there. I guess our first topic is, have the Republicans lost their way? And just to give my basic view from the outset, I subscribe to the Dick Morris view, which is that Bush ran out of ideas in the second year of his term. Basically, he was out of ideas before 9/11. He ran on four ideas: tax cuts, which he'd achieved; his education plan, which he'd achieved; faith-based services, which was trivial and which he didn't really achieve, or he achieved half of, but who cares, and Social Security reform, which wasn't going to happen, and he proved that last year. So he had basically had nothing, and Iraq sort of saved him by giving his presidency a purpose, and he has not supplied anything to fill that void. And no wonder his party's in the doldrums, because he basically has nothing to say, nor does he evince any particular desire to come up with big ideas.
Well, I don't want to ruin this by agreeing with much of that, but actually, in fact, I think there's a lot to that. I think you could rephrase some of it, though. I'm not one of these people who actually looks to Dick Morris as much of a seer or a great opiner about Republican politics, but I think so. At least on one level, your point about how the Iraq War gave Bush purpose—you could argue it the other way, which is that rather than Iraq War giving Bush ideas which he was lacking, it took away his incentive to look for more ideas or to act on other ideas on the conservative plate. It just sucked up all the oxygen. And so while you say, you know, the Iraq War gave him purpose, in a lot of ways you could say, in fact, it siphoned off purpose. It took away the initiative on the domestic front, because there were a lot of conservative ideas out there at one point, and they've just sort of evaporated because the Iraq War became the 800-pound gorilla and everything. I think kind of bigger picture in all of this, I would argue, just to sort of tell you where I am coming from, that that we are still in the midst of Republican realignment. I mean, a lot of this is either cliched or conventional wisdom, but I subscribe to the view that Bill Clinton was essentially the Eisenhower to Reagan's FDR, and that Clinton essentially confirmed the Reagan Revolution in the same way that Eisenhower made the New Deal bipartisan. And so a lot of the stuff, a lot of the arguments that we're having and a lot of the Sturm und Drang we're seeing on the partisan level is happening on the surface of a much larger tectonic sort of phenomenon. And, you know, all these people, I mean, there's a certain credibility gap that a lot of liberals have when they're talking about the conservative crack-up these days, since the liberals have been calling for and predicting and diagnosing a conservative crack-up for some 20, 30 years now. I mean, conservative crack-up has been talked about since the days of Reagan, at least, and at the same time, the Republicans have steadily marched to become the majority party in this country. And so a lot of these arguments that we see about, at least with internal to the GOP, they, to me, are in some ways, maybe not at this moment, but in the last 5 years at least, have been a sign of conservative health. You know, people forget that the FDR coalition included everybody from communist Jews, rabid progressives, blacks, and segregationist southern whites. And they all fought like cats and dogs with each other, and no one ever saw that, you know, the FDR coalition was cracking up for some two generations.
Right, but Peggy Noonan had a pretty good column where she pointed out that FDR was willing to tolerate dissent. He didn't really value loyalty. He wanted his aides to fight things out to see who had the best plan. And Bush is not that kind of president. He's not reaching out for new ideas the way a real governing coalition does. And the classic example is Mitt Romney's health care plan. I mean, here's a big unaddressed problem. The Democrats are going to run on health care. People are upset about health care. They don't necessarily agree on what the problem is, but everybody agrees the current system is a mess. Mitt Romney comes up with a fairly innovative plan to provide universal coverage through the market with some subsidies. You know, a creative president would reach out and promote that idea to national prominence immediately.
I kind of agree with that, but I think in some ways you're talking about a very epiphenomenal thing in terms of Bush's management style. I mean, I think we can stipulate that Bush's management style has shown to have flaws in it over the last few years. But at the same time, when you look at what's going on with the Democrats, you know, everyone seems to think that, you know, everyone has come very close to anointing Hillary Clinton the next Democratic presidential, you know, nominee. And the alternate that people talk about is the guy from Virginia, who's also, you know, who is a real moderate, but Hillary's pretending to be a moderate. And you see how the sort of the gravitational undertow of American politics has moved so far to the right that we may have a Democratic president in 2008, but I don't think we're going to have a left-wing president in 2008 or in 2012 or in 2016. So if you want, I mean, I'm perfectly glad to talk about Bush's problems. My only objection would be that we probably agree on a lot of those problems. I think the administration is listless. I think it is lacking in ideas. I think it has lost energy. I do think that putting in John Bolton is a good sign, and it's good news that the White House will, for the first time, have a real chief of staff. Andy Card wasn't a real chief of staff. He was more like the chief scheduler for the president, because he had all these other people like Rove and Karen Hughes and Dick Cheney who diluted Card's authority. And now you have someone like Bolton who comes in the more historical role of the guy who's going to run the government. And so it may be that we'll see some real ideas percolate to the top again. I thought it was a wonderful sign that Bolton wants to get rid of Harriet Myers, who is the tar patch in the White House legislative or policy process. Nothing gets past her. Everything gets slowed down by her. But, you know, again, focusing on all of these sort of internecine squabbles within the management structure of the White House, I think a lot of people are overreading that as to a sign of the decline of the conservative movement. I have no huge brief for the health of Republicans, except insofar as there are people who carry water for conservative ideas and the conservative cause. And in a lot of ways, a lot of Bush's problems is that he has moved essentially to the left in much the same way Bill Clinton moved to the right. It's centrism that in many ways has created a lot of these problems.
So Clinton's centrism worked. I mean, welfare reform is the classic example, and then most people seem to agree that it was a good thing.
Sure.
Bush's centrism involved private Social Security counts, which were a flop, and this massive, comprehensive immigration reform, which is also flopping, I think. I guess I have a slightly different take. I see, both parties are like Coke and Pepsi, and they're both going to do what's necessary to win, which means that naturally they would gravitate toward a 50-50 split. In other words, if the Democrats get too far to the left, they'll move to the right. If the Republicans get too far to the right, they'll move to the left. What gives the Republicans the advantage is that on some issues, Democrats can't move enough to the center to win because they're tied down by their interest groups, mainly by unions and the African American lobby. So they can't endorse school choice because the teachers' unions won't stand for it, and they can't oppose affirmative racial preferences because the Black Caucus won't stand for it.
Right,
but those are the very two issues that the Republicans are scared to push. They're the issues that the Republicans have dropped. You have the Democrats sitting there, vulnerable, and you don't bring it up.
Mickey, I think we're dancing around the basic fundamental problem, which is I think the Republican Party, especially the Republican House, and the Republican Senate, they're feckless. They suck. I mean, just tactically, they've been idiotic. You know, the Republicans had this huge knockdown, drag-out fight over earmarks. They picked a new new majority leader, and they had this political moment where they could seize on a new agenda. It would seem authentic rather than canned, because they actually had new leadership replacing Tom DeLay. The media was paying attention, and they came out with BOKUS. And that was idiotic, and that was stupid. But if you take a sort of a longer historical perspective about this, the center of gravity of American politics continues, I think, to move to the right. I mean, there are, of course, you're going to get some background noise and variation and all that kind of thing. But, you know, Democrats are now supporting an ostensibly pro-life candidate in Pennsylvania. They've dropped gun control. You had Howard Dean the other day, who you know I'm not a big fan of, but he has the benefit of actually having traveled around the country a lot lately, who's now come out saying he wants to close the borders, and yet you have to have border security. The Democratic Party on the substantive stuff has internalized the fact that it's got to sort of move to the center. And a lot of, I think, the partisan screaming on both sides of this stuff. I mean, one of the reasons why Republicans hated Bill Clinton so much on the substantive stuff was because he was eating our lunch. You know, he picked up on welfare reform, which was essentially a conservative issue. I mean, you know welfare reform stuff better than I do. He picked up on sort of a fundamentally conservative conception about growing the economy. And he talked rhetorically about an assertive foreign policy and all the rest. And so he moved, and the sister soldier stuff and all the rest, he moved the center of gravity of the Democratic Party to the right.
That's my point, that, we're converging on the center. I mean, yes, Democrats have moved to the right on these issues, but Republicans have moved to the left. The effect of Clinton's welfare reform, which eliminated welfare for non-workers, was to reaffirm the welfare state for workers. And the welfare state is as popular as ever. Social Security is still there. Bush failed to reform it. In fact, his major contribution has been an expansion of the welfare state, prescription drug benefits.
That's true.
But it's all moving to the center. Bush is moving to the left, and
your
idea of conservatism just is not going to happen.
Well, it is a fundamental and lamentable fact of conservative life that, you know, conservatism as defined by the board of, you know, the editorial board of the National Review just simply isn't that popular in America and never will be, as is liberalism as defined by the editorial board of the American Prospect. And so you pick your battles and your victories where you can. But I don't think you can deny that over the last 20 years or so since Ronald Reagan, the center of gravity of American politics has been steadily moving to the right. And while George Bush, I entirely agree that compassionate conservatism was not the Republican alternative to Clintonism, it was a Republican version of Clintonism, it is still, I think, the case that the center is slowly moving to the right.
I don't think the center of gravity is moving to the right so much as the center of gravity moves to the right, and now the parties are moving toward converging on the center.
Okay, they're playing catch-up, but...
If you have Hillary against McCain, the ideological differences between them are going to be, minuscule.
Sure, but the ideological differences between McCain and Hillary, the mean difference, or however you want to call it, is going to be way to the right of what the ideological differences were between Ronald Reagan and Walter Mondale, or between Papa Bush and Michael Dukakis. And that's the only... I'm looking to find hope. And that's where I think the hope is.
Yeah, well, I've been reading the National Review's The Coroner, and I've been sensing gloom, not hope.
Oh, no, look, I agree. There is a great deal of gloom. I have not seen a more dispirited bunch of right-wingers in a very, very, very long time, in my entire life. And you are in Washington, and there is a lot of gloom on the right, and I think justifiably so. I don't think that we're going to lose the House or the Senate, but you can make an argument that losing the House would probably be good for Bush, or at least good for conservatives.
Well, let's move to that topic, because that's our next topic, which is what happens if the Republicans do have a setback or even a debacle in November. It seems inconceivable to me that they would pick up seats, but
right.
So the question is, will they lose enough to lose the House? Suppose they do, who does that help? How does that help Bush? You had some scenario.
Well, and I think it would. First of all, one of the things we know that will happen is if the Democrats take back either the House or the Senate, that there will be a ticker tape parade of subpoenas raining down
right.
on the White House.
Well, and one of the things with this CIA leak is that it's clear that the CIA is very worried about this being subpoenaed if the Democrats win one house or the other.
Right. I think that's probably true. But I think the entire White House is worried about being subpoenaed.
Right.
And I think the Justice Department, everyone from the Justice Department to the Department of Defense is probably worried about it.
And how does that help them?
Well, it may be very, very bad news for individual personalities. But, I think one of the things we forget is that one of the reasons why Clinton sort of had this floor in terms of his approval ratings that he couldn't go below was that a lot of Americans just didn't like all the investigations, didn't like all of the attacks. I think, and it rallied a big chunk of the Democratic Party to Clinton's defense, and it turned off the moderates and the independents and all those people, who I don't particularly have a huge amount of respect for. The fetishization of independents and moderates in this country baffles me. But I think you could see a similar dynamic under Bush. Bush, presidents tend to do not necessarily better, but they have certain structural advantages when they're under attack. And I could see in a climate where all of a sudden Democrats want to overreach and overextend and impeach Bush and all of the rest, the American people saying, hey, I thought you guys were coming in here to do the people's business and get things done and all that kind of stuff. And it would also rally a lot of the Republican base, who right now feel like they get a free pass at being critical about Bush for all sorts of reasons, good and bad, who all of a sudden, if the choice is between, Harry Waxman and John Conyers getting their way or George Bush getting their way, they're going to circle the wagons around Bush. And it would give new energy to, the partisans and all that kind of stuff and set up an interesting debate, at least for 2008.
The difference is that Clinton had an appealing platform that people sort of would have liked him to get around to in his second term, which he didn't, say Social Security first. Bush.
Yeah, get those school uniforms out there.
Well, but Social Security was a big idea, and he ran a huge surplus, which has now been dissipated. Those were big popular things. But I thought you were going to say, what I would say is that I don't see how it helps Bush, but I do see how it helps the Republicans, because right now there's a huge pent-up demand for change. If the Democrats win a House, people are going to expect, or the Senate, people are going to expect change, and there will be this rain of subpoenas, and that will sort of provide a safety valve so that by the time 2008 rolls around, McCain will seem like a breath of fresh air.
No, I think that's
Hillary will seem like, more of Speaker Pelosi's subpoenas, and it sets the stage for McCain doing well as opposed to Hillary riding this huge pressure cooker of change if it's really kept bottled up until 2008.
I think that's true. I think also, though, if especially in the House, if Democrats win, the animal spirits will come forth, and you will see some of the uglier side of the Democratic Party getting a voice and getting some power. And that will enable a lot of Republicans to sort of hold up Nancy Pelosi and John Conyers as sort of a Medusa's head to Republicans and say, look, this is who we're going to be stuck with. The people, this is the crowd that's going to take over the government if we don't take it back in 2008.
Well,
that's helpful.
But so suppose the Republicans do badly. There was an interesting debate on the corner. Rich Lowry posted something saying that Newt Gingrich was going to be the big winner if Republicans do badly, because he's predicted they're going to do badly. And that seems insane to me. Nobody likes the guy who predicted that something bad happened. That's the first guy to get killed after when the dust settles.
I'm pretty sure that there are some people in Newt's orbit who are concerned about that point as well. Full disclosure, my wife is doing some work for him right now. I think it's a razor's edge that Newt is sort of walking on, because he certainly, just make it generically, no politician wants to seem like he is benefiting from the failures of his own party. But lots of politicians love to be seen as the voice in the wilderness who said, if you had only listened to me, Churchill in the well of Parliament 10 years before, things got out of hand, if you'd only listened to me, we wouldn't be in this situation. And
that's the one example that everybody cites.
Sure. Well, it's a cliche for a reason. But I don't think you'll be particularly shocked when I say that I think it's pretty fair to say that Newt has somewhat of a Churchillian self-image of himself. And
only Churchill? That's thinking a little small for Newt, isn't it?
And
I thought Newt, Alexander the Great was more...
Newt is planning on being the first lion of the 21st century. And I think that he's, you know, I think he's walking that line. I think, and I do think that, but I do think that, you know, in a party that is saying all of a sudden, hey, we need new ideas, we need a, you know, we need to put a fresh perspective out there and all that kind of stuff, Newt is very capable of doing that. I mean, he is an idea factory. Not all of them, obviously, are ready for prime time.
Well, he needs new ideas. After pushing the Iraq war, when it turned sour, he says, we should never have occupied Iraq, and now we should pull out.
Well,
that seems like opportunism as opposed to a new idea.
Oh, heaven forbid that there are politicians full of opportunism. Look, I mean, he has a great shtick on the you know, on the sort of introducing market forces to healthcare and all that kind of stuff. I'm not sold on Newt. I in no way have drunk the Newt Kool-Aid. I actually don't like anybody of the potential Republican 08 guys right now. You know, I'm still pining for Phil Graham, but as it stands right now, I think he has the ability to at least plausibly for a while say that he is the sort of guy who's going to provide a new intellectual armor for a Republican and conservative agenda. McCain is sort of slightly different. You know, he's got that maverick thing and all that stuff, which I always thought was overblown. But it seems to me that McCain is, in many ways, he's appealing to a lot of people on the right because, you know, he appeals to sort of the Jacksonian impulse among a lot of Republicans who want to fight this war and win it, and he's to Bush's right on the war, which is, I think, sort of an intriguing thing for Republican politics. I mean, who do you think is the winner?
I think McCain's the winner.
Because?
McCain's only Achilles heel, as far as I can see, is his immigration policy, which could conceivably annoy the Republican base so much that he doesn't get the nomination, and also that, you know, becoming too conventional and giving up the maverickness that makes him popular. He might have been better suited to run as an independent. That was always my plan for the guy. But did he listen to me? No.
Who's the last independent who did really well?
Well, my line is always, you know, Ross Perot got 20%, and he's wacky. So McCain isn't wacky. All he needs is 15% more, and you can win a three-way race. So,
okay.
You know, and he's the most popular politician in America, so, or one of the two or three. So that was the theory. And that, you know, parties don't mean that much anymore, blah, 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 blah.
Mm-hmm.
That was the line. Anyway, let's move on to Iraq, since we brought it up.
Okay.
A very ham-handed segue.
There's the bell.
There you go. You had an idea. My attitude toward Iraq tends to be, look, I'm not ready to throw in the towel yet. We need to somehow buy time for the policies we've now put in place to work.
Right.
But you had a different idea, or maybe same idea.
It's sort of a outside of the box, as it were, you know, thought experiment kind of thing. I had this wacky idea, which I'm kind of interested just to hear why it's wrong at this point. That we should figure it out, and it's got to be done very carefully and very cleverly as political theater more than anything else, but we should have a referendum in Iraq asking the Iraqi people whether they want American troops to stay. And I think the benefits of the referendum are manifest and obvious if the referendum passed.
Right, that's not the problem.
Right. And so before we get into that, or even if we don't get into that, I think the reason why I think it would pass is because every time I read, you know, whichever Kaplan it is walking around Iraq these days, you hear this, you know, these sort of stories about Iraqis saying, you know, the Americans stink, but I don't want the Americans to go. And I have to, you know, just back of the envelope math, I would have to assume that a vast majority of the Kurds would want American troops to stay. I would assume that a plurality of the Shia would still want the American troops to stay. And now, since the Sunnis seem to be actually moving towards being sort of a protectorate of the American troops, they might want to stay. Because everyone, if all the talk about civil war being right around the corner is true, and the only thing holding Iraq together are American troops, then you have to sort of assume that a lot of Iraqis understand that better than even we do, and that they would vote their interests. Right now, there are a lot of people who get to bebop and scat all over America, denouncing the quote-unquote occupation and all that kind of thing, and they get to do it for free because they know that, you know, the American troops are going to be there no matter what, so they get to score these populist points against the occupation. But if you ask them in their heart of hearts, would they want the Americans to leave tomorrow, they would probably say, you know, no, because I'll get my throat cut. So if the referendum actually passed, then the occupation argument, the occupation epithet vanishes. It's a reaffirmation of democracy. It forces the Iraqis to appreciate what they get from the occupation and from American help. And it is a huge win for George Bush and America in all sorts of ways.
It seems to me if what you say about people not really wanting us to leave is true, we don't really need a plebiscite. The way for Iraqis to demonstrate that is by turning in the people who are blowing people up and killing people and joining the police force and et cetera, et cetera. But I have a real worry that it wouldn't win. It obviously depends how it's worded. But your description of, you know, you read interviews about how people say, well, you know, the Americans should stick around for a while. Well, I read a lot of interviews before the last election about how people weren't really aligned to the religious parties. There was a secular, more cosmopolitan, silent majority in Iraq that was going to be against the religious parties, and that turned out not to be true. This silent majority didn't exist. Everybody voted for their secular group, and Muqtada Sadr represents a significant part of the population. His whole platform is get the Americans out, and it seems just as likely that politicians would compete with each other for who could most vigorously denounce the Americans.
Yeah, but that's in part because they know they can do it for free, because they know their agenda is not going to succeed. And, it seems to me, from what I read, I mean, I don't claim to be an expert on this, but that Muqtada al-Sadr is kind of likes being bought into the political process at this stage. That could change, obviously, and he's still got his militia, so he's got an escape hatch. But it just seems to me, I mean, I think, obviously, if you know for a fact that a referendum would not pass, then it's probably a pretty stupid idea. But, you know, pointy-headed, you know, blogging heads like us generally have this argument about the value of arguments, about the value of political debate and democracy, and how it tends to shape understanding and inform the public about where their interests are and shake out bad or ill-conceived myths and preconceptions about what reality is. So if you had a serious debate in Iraq about, my gosh, what would actually happen if these guys left, it would be nice to think that a lot of, you know, Iraqis who may not love democracy certainly understand what their interests and where their interests and their safety lies, and would appreciate appreciate the reality of the fact that it's the American occupation that offers the best hope for the future of Iraq. Now, again, if you did it, I think you would have to word it, and you'd have to be pretty sure that you were going to win. But if in the off chance you lost, that still gives America the best face-saving way to get out of Iraq imaginable, because it says, hey, look, you know, we go by the will of the people. We always said if the Iraqis wanted us to go, we would go, and we're not there against their will, and so we're going to take 3 months, we're going to pack up our stuff, and good luck to you guys.
A lot depends on the wording, and that's part of the problem, is that the wording would be perceived as trickery. Probably the popular position in Iraq is American troops should stick around for a while, but within a couple of years they should get the heck out.
Okay.
And why not let one of these weak new elected leaders force the Americans into this position and therefore bolster his authority, as opposed to taking authority away from this fragile government we've just elected and putting it in control of this plebiscite? It seems this is exactly the sort of thing you want, you know, the new president and the new leaders of the parliament to demand of America and force America to do.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting argument, but you may be right. Again, this is sort of, I'm just throwing the idea out there, but it seems to me that if you put it in the hands of a plebiscite, you free up the responsible leadership of the government from having to be blamed for the American occupation. They get to say, hey, look, you know, we put this up for a vote, the Iraqi people decided, it's out of my hands, the next time we can revisit this issue, according to the referenda or whatever it was in 5 years. And until then, let's work with the Americans and fix this place and not be distracted by anti-Americanism. The Iraqi people have spoken.
Okay. Do you have any sense that anybody in the government is listening to your interesting idea?
No. As of yet, no. I got a lot of interesting email from military people who were kind of intrigued by it, but I have no sense that any policymakers are running into some office saying, have you seen what Jonah Goldberg's talking about?
Well, the night is young.
Yes, that's right.
Okay, we have another idea of yours, or at least an interesting blog post that you pointed to, which I guess I'll let you describe, about Arabization and globalization.
In some ways, the real person you should be talking to is Rehan from over at the American Scene. He had a really sort of fascinating discussion.
Is he a right winger or a left winger? I couldn't figure that out.
Oh, I think he's a left winger.
Okay.
But he's sort of a Mickey Kaus left winger, an interesting left winger. He talked about how basically sort of Islamic, the sort of Wahhabism, Islamic, the sort of pan-Islamic Islamism, for want of a better word, is actually a function of globalization as well, and that you're having this sort of transnational cultural aspiration that's spread across the entire world in much the same way that American black sort of street culture has been acquired in lots of countries around the world by various sort of minority or lower class youth. And I just thought it was a very interesting way to look at this, because everyone seems to think that globalization is synonymous with Americanization, which is just sort of flatly not true. And that, in fact, we live in this... my problem is, when you talk about globalization, there's just so many cliches that you don't want to spout. But, you certainly don't want to sound like Tom Friedman. But, we do live in this world where there are many competing forms of globalization. After all, the supposedly anti-globalization crowd loves all sorts of things about the UN and wants to talk about world environmental policy and all the rest. So they're competing globalizations.
Well, that's Bob Wright's point, that the opposition to globalization is itself another form of globalization.
Yeah, no, I think that's right. He's written interesting stuff about that. And I think that we don't appreciate that enough, and we don't use that enough to our advantage. If you can persuade people to understand, at least at some level, that the choice isn't between their indigenous culture and American culture, but between this really nihilistic, unproductive culture that is being exported from places like Saudi Arabia and a free and open culture where you get to sort of choose and wear whatever culture you want as your own fashion statement, then it makes the appeal of Islamism and all the rest much less, because right now it's this nihilistic sort of jihadi culture which has the appeal of authenticity to it, which is giving a lot of people cause to sort of pick it up and wear it on their sleeves. When in reality, a lot of this sort of Wahhabi stuff is wiping out indigenous, interesting Islamic cultures in various parts of the globe in terms of this one cookie-cutter approach.
That was the point of the Rehan article, which is... there are all sorts of sort of localized Arab cultures that are wiped out in the name of the one true faith coming from Mecca,
right?
The approved Wahhabi version of Islam, and that maybe there was some way to harness these weird indigenous syncretic fusions of Islam and local culture, especially in South Asia, and say, look, if you want you want your local culture wiped out, then join the radical Islamic side of the culture war. If you want to preserve it, actually, American globalization is really just sort of a neutral technology that you can use to preserve your own local culture. You can put it up on the web. You can do
right.
all sorts of things to preserve it. The problem I had with this is that all the examples of indigenous culture thriving under localization, under globalization, like Bollywood, seems to be pathetically weak. I mean, Bollywood is exhibit A for globalization. It's India now has a Western-style film industry.
Indian films are not Western films.
Of resistance to globalization.
Yeah, but Indian film is, if you ever watch Indian films, they are not Western-style films. It's a Western-style industry in terms of its marketing and whatnot, but the actual contents of the films is, you know,
pretty
different.
Well, they have musical numbers. What else?
I'm sorry?
They have musical numbers. What else?
Oh, well, look, I mean, the men and women aren't allowed to touch or kiss or any of that kind of stuff. I mean, it's certainly not the sort of, you know, pandering of sex that you would see in terms of American or Hollywood movies. I agree with you. You're gonna give up little bits of yourself under globalization, because there's going to be this sort of reduction to the mean to some extent, but you have a lot more freedom to indulge your own indigenous culture under our version of globalization than you do under the Islamic version of globalization. In large parts of Europe, you know, these once dying out languages are starting to make a comeback. Various forms of Celtic language are coming back and all that sort of thing. And, you know, a lot of it may be opposed and not too authentic by our lights, but it's certainly more authentic than what you would get under the sort of rubber stamp of the Salafis or the Wahhabis or whatever you want to call them.
I guess I tend to still put my money on the general sense that Islamic radicalism is not conducive to prosperity for nations. Not that it's not conducive to local indigenous character and differentiation, but just that, you know, if you're Saudi Arabia or the current government of Iran, you're just not going to make a whole lot of money, and you're not going to you're going to be a sort of loser in the global race for.
Well, I mean, I think that's true, but I mean, I think that's absolutely true. But why should sales pitches be reduced to one reason? I mean, you know, you sell a car because it's fast and because it gets good mileage and because it's safe. You can sell American style. You know, the American choice, let's call it, over the jihadi choice for a lot of reasons. You'll be able to provide better for your kids. You'll be able to keep some of your cultures. You'll be able to do, you know, some of your culture. You'll be able to do what you want in your own home. Your women will be able to learn how to read. I mean, the reasons why our system is superior to their system is a long list. It's not just, you know, it have to be one point.
Well, that's a good point. I'm now less skeptical of this idea. That is, globalization, our globalization isn't just McDonald's. It also gives you the tools you need to preserve what's not global about you.
Yeah, I think that actually has the benefit of being true.
Even better.
Yeah, and in the marketplace, you know, I mean, you see all these fair trade sort of, you know, Sandalista stores where people are buying things of indigenous cultures from various places. And certainly in a boutique kind of way, our choice of globalization gives you at least the possibility of selling your culture, of keeping your culture, and making a buck from it.
Good point. we veered to agreement again. This is a disaster.
Damn you, cows!
The ratings are going to sink. Okay, well, let's try at least disagree on this last one, which is immigration.
Okay.
I doubt we'll disagree, actually. Congress is coming back. Immigration is supposed to be a hot issue. It's rising in salience in the polls. Fred Barnes wrote an article, which I sniped at last week, on he claims the tide has turned for President Bush on this issue. And I am sort of worried that if you know, unless you're a low-wage worker or somebody in the construction industry, or you have these sort of highly abstract fears about, you know, irredentism, will parts of California want to become part of Mexico in 20 years. There's a lot for you in immigration, even illegal immigration, and people might really value their nannies and you know, their good, cheap local workers more than they do the security of their borders, and in fact, there might be something to this pro-Bush wave.
I think you're probably right on a lot of the substance. I think Fred's wrong on a fundamental point at this point. Bush is sufficiently unpopular that even if he's on the winning side of the issue, I don't know that it helps him too much. It may result in legislation that he can claim victory for, and you know, on that level, Bush is probably on the political right side of things, but immigration's not the best issue for him to win some centrist victory. I mean, Bush has been relying on this, you know, govern from your base strategy for a very long time now, and there is no issue, I would say even abortion, included, that riles the base more of the Republican Party than immigration. And I think at this stage for Bush, to win a centrist victory will not win him many people over, certainly not many Democrats, and very few centrists or independents, and it will cost him dearly on his own base. So I think he would actually, even if he technically won, he would lose, because he would certainly lose more support than he would gain, and that support is the support he needs most, which is from his base. It's my theory.
But Bush isn't running for re-election. All he cares about is retaining control of Congress, so he wards off these subpoenas.
But that base matters for the Republican, for 06.
Doesn't the base deliver for the local congressman, even if Bush is way too liberal? The local congressman will be tough.
Well, I mean, who's going to be voting for Bush? I mean, it depends who votes for Bush's, immigration plan. If it passes, if it's sort of a McCain majority with mostly Democrats and a few centrist Republicans, that could really tick off the base for, at their Republicans. I mean, they could stay home. I cannot convey to you how unbelievably divisive immigration is among rank-and-file Republicans. The email that we get on it, at the slightest sign of apostasy or sort of centrism on this, is just astounding to me. And I just don't know that this is the best issue for Bush. Maybe it is.
I guess if Bush is wildly unpopular, then the base gets dispirited, even if their local congressman is James Sensenbrenner, who is, or Tom Tancredo, a very get-tough...
Or Bush becomes more popular by getting 5% of the sort of middle-of-the-road moderates and centrists, but loses 10% of the hardcore right-wingers.
See, I think he's realized that. I think if you read the note today, they have a little quiz where they pose two possibilities. One is Congress passes 75% of McCain-Feingold, which means some form of amnesty or semi-amnesty or earned something, legalization or citizenship, for illegals currently in the country, coupled with tough border control. All these plans have allegedly
right.
tough border control. Or Congress just passes tough border control and it sort of runs for re-election on that. And they seem to imply that Bush favored the latter approach, that he realizes that if he wants to hold Congress... the real hot button that chases away the base and discourages Republicans is any sort of amnesty or semi-amnesty for people currently in the country illegally.
I think that's right. I mean, you've seen Bill Frist. I mean, Bill Frist has just sort of been demonstrating that he doesn't know what he's doing of late, coming up with these compromises. It seemed for a minute that he looked like he understood that the base wants border security first and only, and then we'll talk about the rest later. And then he just sort of, he squishified before our eyes.
He got spooked by, the respectable op-ed writers or something.
I think that's right. And that's the kind of guy that he is.
Yeah.
He's a greenhouse effect kind of guy. And I think that what was more telling, and I sort of mentioned this briefly earlier, was when Howard Dean got up and said, first thing you got to do is close the borders. You got to tighten the borders, control the borders. Now, I may not believe him or trust him on that issue, but I think it is a sign that, because of his, that's my doorbell, because of his 50-state strategy and all this going around the country talking to people, he understands where the public is at. Those are my dogs up there barking away. Here they come.
Are you sure those aren't illegal dogs?
Oh, hold on. Release the hounds. I'm sorry
this will
about
be the
that.
First Bloggy Heads episode eaten by dogs. is that the famed Cosmo, by the way?
That was the famed Cosmo, the wonder dog, the it dog of the American right, and his partner in crime, Buckley, who's actually my sister-in-law's dog that we're dog sitting.
But we should emphasize that what Frist proposed is under the guise, I see calling for tough borders is like people saying welfare recipients should work. Everybody
right.
says that now.
Right.
The question is the details, and are you really going to make it work with welfare
right.
reform, and are you really going to close the borders and stand up to employers?
Right. It's like saying it's like saying no one's in favor of abortion. Everyone's technically in favor.
The only person who stood up, bucked the tide, and said he was in favor of illegal immigration is Bill Kristol of the Weekly Standard.
Yeah, I knew that was coming.
And on Brit Hume, he said the I'm a liberal on immigration. What damage have they done that's been so great in 20 years? What's happened that's so terrible in the last 20 years, that since the last amnesty in 86? Is the crime rate up in the United States? Is unemployment up in the United States? And they've been contributing to the U.S. economy. I am pro-immigration, and I'm even soft on illegal immigration. So that's Bill Kristol, the leader of one of the leaders of the conservative movement in America, being soft on illegal immigration. And, you know, there's something to what Kristol said. It plays into this sense that I was talking about earlier, which is, you know, we sort of like having illegals around. They're good people. They're the sort of people you'd want to immigrate if you could get them to immigrate legally. And but there are two problems. What Kristol said is so elitist. I mean, yes, he's obviously not a construction worker trying to make a living building houses where you compete against people who are making half your wage.
Right.
And he's also very comfortable living in an America with vast inequalities of income and social status. You sort of get the feeling that as long as people keep bringing in his books from the library, he'll be happy. He has to sort of care what they do when they leave, you know, leave his apartment. That's a very mean way to put it, but that's...
Well, I hate to say it, but I think it's somewhat fair, or at least it's understandable that it would give that impression. I thought it was, for want of a less loaded term, it was a remarkable sign of Bill Kristol's cosmopolitanism. And
watch it.
And, I know. And I just thought it was a deadly thing to say, and intellectually irresponsible.
To say what he really thought.
Well, but no. I mean, it's a position that's intellectually irresponsible. To say you're soft on illegal immigration is to basically say that you're not in favor of having any immigration policy. Because if you don't think illegal immigration is bad, or that it really sort of exists as a category of something, then you really don't believe in legal immigration either. You just believe in chaos. And you believe in whoever gets here should get here, and whoever can't. And it's sort of ludicrous. It's perfectly intellectually defensible. I'm very pro-immigration. I would have no problem with, you know, having very large numbers of legal immigrants to the United States, but zero illegal immigrants. And if you think that having lots and lots of poor immigrants in the United States is good, well, then you should be in favor of a law that says we should have lots and lots of poor immigrants. Right. You shouldn't just say, I'm just going to turn a blind eye to it, because those laws don't matter.
It is a position. It's a libertarian open borders position.
Even a libertarian would say, you know, at least get right with the law. And that's not what Bill was saying there. He was basically saying the law, you know, the law is sort of this trivial objection because the policy, you know, the repercussions aren't that bad.
Right.
And that's not defensible.
And he has a point. I mean, another part is, of course, that I'm sure his family is fairly recent immigrants, and one does tend to romanticize the immigrant experience, even the illegal immigrant experience. I think my grandmother did a little finagling to get in the country herself. It's not just snobbery, but there's a lot of snobbery involved. I mean, basically, Kristol is saying he's comfortable living in a city with the disparities of Rio de Janeiro, and I'm not. I don't think most Americans are.
I think that's right. Or at the very least, he just thinks. I mean, I think it's pretty well known that Bill and the guys at the Weekly Standard generally just don't think immigration is that important an issue. I've heard that for years. John Podoritz had a couple posts in the corner a while back where he was just saying, you know, all these polls saying that immigration is a big issue are misleading. It's really not a big deal. It's not important. They just don't. They don't want to talk about it, and they don't think it's interesting, and so they denigrate it and trivialize it.
I thought they think it's the key to cementing a Republican majority for generations.
I'm not sure that's true. I mean, if that were true, then you would be in favor of actually having a policy about all of this. I mean, and one of the problems that we have is that we talk about immigration as if it's this abstract thing. We are talking about immigration from Mexico. I mean, that is really what it is all about. And a lot of neoconservatives... think they want to keep the story about the narrative of immigration generally, because Americans like to talk about immigration generally as being a positive story and a help to America, and so they muddy the waters with all of it.
Actually, it's not. Some anti-immigrant or anti-illegal people like Mark Krikorian argue that Mexico is not the story of the future. First, there's going to be a birth dearth in Mexico, and they may run out of people to send to us. And second, Mexican workers, in world terms, are relatively high-wage workers. And if you're a greedy American employer wanting to import low-wage workers from abroad, you aren't going to look to Mexico. You're going to look to other places, like Bangladesh, and places where they have really poor people. So this idea that it's just going to be Mexico, that the Mexico is, you know, is the entire reality of potential low-wage immigration, Krikorian says is wrong.
Well, yeah, but I mean, but again, sorry, look, here's my position on this, is we got lots of immigration problems, not an immigration problem, singular. We have plural immigration problems. And some of it has to do with H-1B visas, some of it has to do with terrorists coming into the northern border and all that kind of stuff, and some of it has to do with the fact that we share a 2,000-mile-long border with Mexico. It is much, much easier to keep poor illegal immigrants from Bangladesh out of the United States than it is to keep poor illegal immigrants out of the United States from Mexico. And so they're just different things.
Sure.
Bangladeshis have to swim to get here, or fly.
If you had a I guess what Kikori is saying, if you had a suppose we passed a gigantic guest worker program, and the compromise in the Senate is pretty gigantic. It basically has, according to Senator Sessions' interpretation, no ceiling on the size of the guest worker program.
Mm-hmm.
If you had a guest worker program that allowed 10 million people into the country, those people would not come from Mexico.
I think that's fair, but I think that's a fair point and an interesting point to raise. But it is not where the debate about immigration in the United States is. It's this border state thing about waves and waves of Mexican immigrants. It's all that Reconquista stuff. The irredentism and all of that is rooted in a specific historic experience. And people who want to make these analogies to Italy at the turn of the 20th century, the beginning of the 20th century, forget that we didn't share 2,000-mile-long border with Italy. They're just different things.
I agree completely. I'm trying to figure out what the analogy is to counter the point at which Kristol is right, which is the 20 years since the Simpson-Mazzoli bill, where we gave an amnesty and the result was not to control our borders, but to have millions and millions of more illegals be attracted by the prospect of a future amnesty. Those haven't been bad years, and they haven't been bad unless you were a construction worker or a low-wage worker. And even then, they just weren't such bad years. And I guess the analogy is drugs. I mean, the first hit of heroin is pretty good, too.
Yeah,
it's the second and third where you let in another 20 million and another 20 million where you run into trouble.
Well, and also, I mean, I I'm not one to quote Krugman and that often, but, like George Borjas has a piece in the latest National Review. I think there's a very credible case to be made that the that illegal immigrants or immigrants in general, poor immigrants in general, have been a wet blanket on wages. I mean, that just sort of seems obvious to me. And in fact, it's new immigrants holding down the wages of, Bob Samuelson had a good column on this last week. It's new immigrants holding down the wages of fairly recent immigrants. That's one of the reasons why Italian wages and Irish wages at the beginning of the 20th century started to rise is because they weren't replaced by a new wave of poor illegal immigrants. And when you keep the spigot open, you have a situation where you are constantly creating a downward pressure on those wages. Now, I think there are a lot of good things that come from those low wages, too, in terms of productivity and all sorts of good things for the consumers. I don't think it's all one or the other. But I think Bill is being very dismissive about the wages of the lowest, the bottom two quintiles of the population, because we don't know how much higher those wages would have been if you didn't keep having this new, not to sound Marxist, surplus army of low-wage, of lumpen proletariat workers.
No, I agree. This is very dispiriting. We've completely failed. Not only are we agreeing with each other, but we're agreeing with Paul Krugman.
That's going to get me written out of the movement. That's the problem.
This is a total disaster, and I think we should probably stop before this bomb of agreement spreads further.
Fair enough. It's a virus.
And and you can let the dogs out now.
Okay. I'm sorry for the interruptions back there. It's a
no,
problem with setting this up in my home.
The production values that make blogging ads popular.
Okay. Well, I'm delighted to have done this. If you ever have me back, I will try to find things that I'm vicious and nasty and disagreeable about.
Yes, you've been much too likable. We were obviously sold a false bill of goods here.
I'm sorry.
Anyway, this has been great. Let's do it again.
Okay, thanks, Mickey.
See you, Jonah.
Bye.